Okay, I'm about to start my first recording session with Katie. I don't know what the day's gonna bring. I can't keep talking all day long, you know, because I'm doing the studio.
So opportunity knocked on my door. I chose to let it in. I picked my backbone off the floor. 'Cause I had to fight to win. And now this movie can begin. You say I'm down to earth from what you see. You say I'm normal, but what does that mean?
Everyone, it's Plastic EP coming in from Melbourne, Australia. We've got Sabine, she's coming in from the UK, and we've also got Susie Quattro. I don't know, everybody out there in the world, we just love Susie, especially here in Australia. We can't wait for your tour. And we're here because of your new album, which is called Face to Face, and it's all duets with KT Tunstall. And let me tell you, I've seen the video clips. And they got to go out and buy the album on August the 11th. And, of course, the first song is already out, which is called Shine the Light. We want everyone to go out there and buy it.
It's been going unbelievably great because across the board, and I've done maybe 350 interviews so far, everybody is going nuts. Wow. Nuts. You know, they're saying things, if I paraphrase, because, you know, once you've done a few interviews, You get the feeling of what's being thought about the product. And it's all about, we love the songs. What a journey. What a journey. What a message. We love the blend of your voices, which nobody knew. A review the other day said it was a blend that you only get with siblings. Wow. And, you know, we went the distance on this. This album is a journey. And we are cut from the same cloth. And we discussed different subjects. Maybe 45 minutes, she'd stay overnight, we'd sit on my carpet barefoot, and we'd talk. And as we're talking, there's an idea coming. Though, like Shine the Light, we were talking about fame, and people say it's luck, and all that. And we were writing down lines as we're talking, and all of a sudden, there's Shine a Light right in front of us, staring in front of us. KT is a little bit more folky. I'm a little bit more rocky, but a lot more rocky. And we met somewhere in the middle. I leaned to her, she leaned to me, and we created something new, which is fantastic. We did not know this was going to happen, but it did.
Congratulations to your son, right? L.R. Tucky, for doing a fantastic producing job of the album. And I've got to say, he really is a great producer. You must be so proud.
I am so proud because he came to me first in 2019. He was a musician in bands since 14, same as his mom. And he said, I want to write some songs with you. And I went, oh, okay, what you got? You know, and that turned into the album No Control, which charted around the world. He co-wrote and played guitar with me on that. Then they took up the option and we did The Devil and Me. He co-wrote and played guitar on that with me. And that charted around the world. Then we did the Uncovered EP. He produced that and played guitar. Then, as KT and I were kind of nearly finished writing and we're putting down basic tracks and all that, and I said, do you want Richard, my son, to put some electric on? And because he had played on the first three demos that we did together. And she said, we were on the Skype, she said, you tell Richard to take those tracks and do whatever he thinks is necessary. And then she said, and you tell Richard, I'm officially asking him to produce the album. Now, as his mother, I did this bullshit thing and tried to act like, oh, yeah, that's fine. And I went, KT, I got to go. There's somebody at the door. There wasn't anybody at the door. I had to get off the phone and go, Richard, you're producing the album. And I was on breakfast TV with KT the other day. And in a break, I actually said, I have a confession to make. Any mother would do that. Oh, somebody's at the door. Bye, talk to you later. Richard!
Now, I want to congratulate you, Susie, on the Heritage chart for being number two, and we're here to push it to number one. I'm sure you're going to get to number one. We've got our fingers crossed, and we hope it happens straight after this show. And Sabine was suggesting that your next album be an album of duets and also have Alice Cooper on it because you're from Detroit, and Alice Cooper loves you, so you've got to make sure you ask Alice.
We actually love each other. We've known each other forever. You know, we're good friends. And funny enough, on my list of names that I'm going to be doing, Susie Quattro and Friends, I am doing that. That's happening. So your suggestion is already in the pipeline. And Alice is one of the names on there. Absolutely. I would not. He would be one of the first people I would ask.
Now, because Paul McCartney is touring Australia, well, when he finishes his Australian tour, ask him to join you. For me, that's Paul to join you, right?
There you go. There you go. I've had dinner with Paul. He's a very nice guy. We had a long conversation. Very nice person and good bass player.
You know Paul McCartney's known for the bass, but right up there is Susie Quattro that's known for the bass forever. So, I mean, how does it feel to be in that company when you talk about music history? I mean, that to me is like blown my mind. Always. From the start, when you started in the 70s and I was at high school, and everybody was buying your album and saying how great it was. I mean, you know, you're the original. And as I said, doesn't matter what happens, you will always be known as the original.
There was a poll in Playboy quite a few years ago now. And I was listed as one of the top three bass players in the world. I now have resurrect 5.5 minute long bass solo from 1979. I put it back in the show. And it is killer. If you want to really watch something good, Google Susie Quattro bass solo Vienna. That's a good one. 2023, and it's become one of the highlights of the show. And I resurrected it because through the years the solo changed depending on what drummer I had. You know, if they couldn't quite keep up, then I had to adjust the solo. And my husband and other people kept saying to me, "Why aren't you doing that 1979 solo anymore? Why is that not in the show anymore?" Because I have a solo, but it altered. And then finally, my husband said the golden words. He said, "Oh, you probably can't play like that anymore." I went, right. You just watch. So, and then the final song, my drummer in my band came up to me and said, "Why aren't we doing that solo?" And then it was in. Then it was in. Done. And I'm so glad I reintroduced it, you know, and it's fantastic. I love doing it.
Well, look, you've had an amazing career. And as I said, I just saw The Angels, the documentary, right? And then you pop up in the documentary. Not going to say The Angels, to me, are one of the greatest Australian bands that ever were. And the sound they had and the songs they had were great. And I appreciate the fact that you realise how great they were. And to be on that documentary to me is unbelievable. And even the Susie Q documentary, and the guy from Melbourne here produced it and was director. I saw it in Carlton here in a cinema, right? And when I saw it, it blew me away when we went through your family history, your sisters, the band, the Pleasure Seekers. It was like unbelievable. Your career has just gone from the start and you just became this star that took over the world with your sound and your look. You know, the 70s, as I said, with the leather suit, there was no one like that. And you were the original. And this is why we pay tribute to you, Susie, because I want you to know the world loves you. That's a fact. You know, you're Susie Quattro and you'll always be Susie Quattro. You're rocking out more than ever now in 2023. And you are a true music legend.
Thank you very much. Everybody always asks me, and all the time, did I know, you know, that I was changing the world? And I'm honest about it. I did not know. I was just very stubbornly being who I was and taking a chance that the world was going to accept it. And they did. But I discovered it in hindsight, watching the documentary, the end of 2019, it came out over in England. And I went to the Regent's Theatre in London and was going to do the Q&A at the end of the movie being shown. I hadn't seen it with a big audience in a big theater. And I was supposed to come on at the end, but I snuck in to watch it. And every few minutes, another woman appeared on the screen. You know, Debbie Harry, Joan, Cherie Curry, Lita Ford. And they all, if you squeeze it in and paraphrase it, they all said basically the same thing. They said they would not have done what they did if it hadn't been for me. And I started to cry because I didn't know I had done that. And then it dawned on me, I was sitting there crying going, I did that? And then I called my friend the next day, Cherie Curry, she's become a good friend. And I was telling her that story, and you'll love this. And I said, Cherie, I just realized something. She said, what? I said that by me doing what I did, I gave permission to women all over the world to be different. And there was a long silence. And then she went, and you just got that?
I got to say something about Australian culture, Susie. You understand, like in the 60s, everything was coming from the States, right? American beach movies, and we got our culture from that. You playing Leather Tuscadero, right, on the Happy Days has embedded you in Australian culture forever. And everybody remembers you and the Fonz, right, on that show. And it's just a fact. It's like the Brady Bunch. It's like the Partridge Family. You are there in pop culture forever just for that TV show and that role. That's how big Happy Days was here in Australia. And I want you to know that you're part of the Australian culture fabric. How does that feel?
Feels fantastic. I took the choice to go and audition for that show. And Ronnie Howard, I've remained friends with, and Henry, I've remained friends with. But Ronnie Howard said to me, I never felt like I was new to the show. I'm sure the audience will agree. I was just there. It's like I always was there. And I never felt like a new actress. So he gave me a big compliment. But it was a great show to do. And I'm honored to be part of TV history. And that is history. I found out when I went back to Paramount, 2 or 3 years, I did 77, 78, and 79 seasons. And I went back in like 1980 or something to Paramount to say hello to everybody. And the secretary there said to me, I want to tell you something. You got the second most fan mail after Henry. I went, wow, okay, hey.
John Lennon went to visit the set of Happy Days.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Susie, we just want to ask you what the crowds are in every country all over the world. The reaction you've had to the fans, do you find them different in different countries to your show and to yourself, or is it all universal?
Well, my show is my show, and I do have my eyes and my ears on every single audience because every audience is different. It's the same in a way because it's the songs, but I don't ever go up there and just think, oh, here's another show. I go up there like it's my first show, and I go up there like it's a fight that I have to win everybody over, and I hope that they all go home happy. And if they haven't gone home happy, then it's my fault, not theirs. And I will stand on my head if I have to make sure that happens. I'm an old-fashioned performer. I take it very serious.
I want everyone to go out and buy your new album, right? Susie Quattro and KT Tunstall, Face to Face, released on August the 11th. Go now and buy a single, Shine a Light. It's out now. And as I said, the fans support you. The fans love you. And you are the greatest and a rock and roll legend. and the Queen of Rock.
Thank you very much.
Truth is my weapon. It's the only one I've got. I don't need no bullets. This is the gun without a shot. I learned my lesson when more often than not. So leave these lies behind. 'Cause I got truth.